This is August 12th, 2010, and we are in the home of Annette and Henry Stevens to hear about growing up here in Wilmot. Your full name?
Henry L. Langley Stevens.
There's the Langley.
Yeah.
And you were born in what year?
1938, July 28th.
And you were born right on the farm?
Right on the farm.
Right on the farm. You lived there your whole growing up life?
My whole life.
Until you were 19.
Were your father and mother from Wilmot, or where were they from?
My mother was from Wilmot. My father came from South Denver.
Of course she was, yeah. She was from Wilmot.
Yeah. Right at the old Stevens place, just across the town line on South Danby Road. It's actually the third house on the left end.
Where Marilyn Ray lives now.
They had maple syrup. They had a sugar house down there and stuff like that. And everybody had sugar houses, either that or they made their own. Like I used to make my own, and I was on the farm up there. When I moved down here, every 2 years, I'd tap John Moss's trees or who I was and bring scrap wood home from work and make 5 or 6 gallons. That was enough to go for 2 years.
Are there any stories about you as a baby that have roamed around the family?
Yes. About Grandpa Sida.
Oh. I guess I was about 2.5, 3 years old. My grandfather always had a barrel of cider.
That's the only thing Graham would allow was cider.
You could get drunk on cider, but that was all right. If you got drunk on beer or liquor, that was terrible.
Isn't that funny?
So he always took me down. Well, they couldn't find me one day. And that's back when they had the sewing circles.
Oh, yeah.
Twice a month. Well, they had a big thing coming. A lot of women coming that day. Well, like, finally they looked down cellar. And there I was. Drunk on a skunk. I drained the cider of her. I couldn't even stand up, I guess. And my mother come down. She said, I drank all a bump of cider or something like that. It was funny.
Did you have many brothers and sisters? Were you a big
I had one brother and two sisters. One, my brother, I got Nancy and Lee, they're twins. My other sister, she's what, Marie, she's in Concord.
Year and a half or
just so about a year and a half younger than I am. I had an uncle, more of a father to my own father, really. Bob Stewart, and he just took me hunting. He started me fishing when I was young and started me off hunting when I was young. But we didn't do nothing. I mean, we stayed there. It'd be nothing to stay right there for a week, like, you know, when you was young. You didn't travel.
Yeah.
You didn't have the money to travel.
Yeah.
If you did, you just, like, I used to ride my bike down to South Danbury, then somebody come bring me a ride home, but we had kids down that way, some of my relations. We used to go down and play ball and stuff like that. But my grandmother Stevens, she lived down there too. My grandmother had boarders in the summertime, so, you know, that kept us busy haying with my grandfather and stuff like that when we were kids and stuff. When I was a kid growing up, there was more farms than was in 57 because a lot of them went out before then.
But Willard Ford's farm was there.
But Willard Ford's farm was one in particular because it was right on the Danbury-Wilmot line, and the selectmen used to come around assessing the property on April 1st for the taxes, and they used to count all the livestock, cows, chickens, pigs, and everything. And so he'd take his animals and stick them on one side of the barn, and then the Danbury would be there, and they'd stick them on the other side of the barn. We had a lot of farms back then. In North Wilmot alone, there was 6, 7. Howard Atwood's.
Howard Atwood was his grandfather.
You know, my grandfather, that was a farm I was born and brought up on. Chan Sires, Sidney Sargent's. And the clay farm, I don't remember that one really working. Myron Langley's, Fred LaJoy, when he lived in North Wilmot, he had a farm on top of the hill over there. Clinton Fowler's.
What were most of the crops or animal life?
There was just cattle. Cattle, and a lot of them had horses. The to work with, and some of them had steers to work with. But when the tractors come in, and of course everything else went out, but my grandfather was strictly horses, because he died in the spring of 58, and that's all he ever used was horses and stuff, and that's why I was born and brought up. When I got old enough to drive, that's what I done, drive the horses and stuff. But,
They had big gardens too, didn't they?
Because well, everybody had big gardens because they didn't have no freezers, didn't have no refrigerators. We had all ice boxes, and we used to cut our ice at White's Pond. And it was
which
on Howard Atwood's farm.
White's Pond.
Okay.
That's right where Camp Wilmot is now, or used to be. That's another thing that bugged me too.
Henry's grandmother used to do a lot of canning for Proctor Academy. That's why they had big gardens. She would do 2.5-quart canning jars of vegetables. And
they'd bring most of the vegetables with them, though. But everybody had big gardens back then. They had to survive. Mm. And pigs, most of the time they had pigs, chickens, you know. Somebody come for unexpected, they'd go out in the barn and kill a chicken and have it for no time flat. They always had something to eat. You never had to worry about food back then. But my grandfather was a road agent. Back then we had two road agents, one in this section and one from north section. But I guess they used to have 5 or 6 because they had drags and didn't have any graders. I forget what year we got our first grader. It was back in probably, I'd say probably 51 or 52, somewhere along in there. And Fort Patton was a road agent down here. Mm-hmm. I was my road agent. Mm-hmm. And they swap back and forth with a grader back and forth between the two. Things have changed a lot. When I got my license, I drove the grader. I plowed with it in the wintertime. In 57, I was in March. We had 5 feet land in 2 different snowstorms, a 3-footer and a 2-footer. I just got home from one of the big storms. I didn't even undress. She fed me supper. I laid on the couch and went to sleep, and she was pounding on me in about 3 or 4 hours. I had to start plowing again. I had almost 100 hours in that week driving. We had the old Klee Track tractor. You remember that, Charles?
I do indeed. With the chain
and fall. That, yeah, the chain fall and stuff like that. It took 3 men to run it.
Yeah.
And, you know, they switched back and forth.
Yeah.
One storm, but that's what the main thing they had to plow with when they started with. First, it would be down here. For one storm, then after it was cleaned up here, they'd go up Wilmot Center that way.
Mm-hmm.
They switch back and forth. We got snowed in up there 3 days one time. But
well, that bad storm, you ended up, you lost the road by...
Oh, Cappy Levine, you know where Cappy lived and stuff. Yeah, I lost the road to the grader.
You spent the night at Cappy's.
Yeah, we stayed right there. It was a good thing he had a telephone. I just called her up and said, I'll see you when I get there. But, yeah, we had things that people don't realize how easy they got it now compared to what we had back then. It, 75 cents an hour driving. And the road agent had $1.25 an hour back then. But, you know, the different things weren't so high priced then. You could buy gas by a gallon for $1, you know, back then.
Now, did you live right opposite your grandfather?
I just lived up just on top of the hill. Okay. I was the next right house down below Clara's.
Okay. Yep.
Well, so we were married in 57. The only time I left town was about 3 weeks, maybe.
A month. I'll give you a
month. Most in Concord, over on the Heights, where the playground is now. We had a house there we rented for $35 a month. I said, she come home one night, I said, pack your bags, so we're getting out of here.
See, I had a job when we got married, and he didn't.
I've had one ever since.
And I worked in Concord, so we had the apartment in Concord, so I wouldn't have to travel.
I worked at Brother Tanner.
It was like, back then, Loudon Road was like Wilmot Flat is now.
That's right.
But that was city, and he wasn't.
Yeah, I'd make a good money down there, and then they put me on hand finishing. I knew I was going to get fired. I couldn't keep up. The women was in there, and they took all the good stuff, and I was getting all the crap, and I was wasting more clothes,
A lot of people worked there.
Oh, a lot of people worked there. It was a good paying job.
Yeah.
What kind of a job was it again?
A tannery.
I was a hand finishing suede. First job I ever had, really, they took Social Security out and we built a campground road. I worked for the state then. bad. We had to spread sand off the back of the truck because it was penetration, because they had the bicycle sanders and they couldn't back up, they'd run over them. We had to put enough sand to keep the asphalt from bleeding up through. Wilbur, I had started off with Wilbur Grace and he cramped up. Harry Hunt had somebody else. You jump off in one truck, of course, he's only had 3 or 4 yards on him, man. 10 hours, one truck to another truck all day long. Who I ended up with was Harry Hunt. I worked between her father's sawmill and driving for the town. And we, the snow got so deep, we just couldn't do any more in the woods and stuff. It was a two-man operation, her father and I.
Before skidders.
With log, and we had 2 big international tractors and stuff, and I was scared to death coming down there, about 1,000 feet of logs right behind me. You had to steer the screw, you wasn't, that's before the skidders come in.
Yeah.
What was your job, Annette?
I worked at, used to be Farm Bureau Insurance, now it's Concord Group. Back when they were on Main Street, they used to be right, almost right across from Sears Roebuck, when Sears was on Main Street.
Well, I got married the year, same year I got out of high school. And we asked them to marry us up the North Wilmot Church. We was the second couple that ever got married in that church. Mm-hmm. What gets me, they, in the inner town record, they named Piper Pond Road. They never named Tewksbury Road. There's 3 roads right there that come in right there to the church. They only named 2 out of the 3, but you know, it's an intersection, because that's the road from Tewksbury's. That's why the church had moved down to off the hill.
That's right.
They used our wedding pictures when the church was broken into and all the antique lanterns were stolen.
Yeah.
Chandelier and the whole works. Yeah.
Now the chandelier didn't get that because they couldn't,
I guess so,
the way it was fastened up, they couldn't get it out. But those were the only photographs that they had to show the insurance adjusters.
I shingled that church twice. Once for another guy, Wayne Atwin, when he was in business, and when I was in business, I shingled it once. And we shingled the Wilmot Center Church once. So many people don't even know there's a church on top of the hill.
Yeah, I know it. Mm-hmm. June 14th,
1957.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I remember, yeah. That was a big Methodist church on top of the hill.
He just got it all painted.
Yeah.
Wesley Wood, he just got all his equipment out that day that the lightning struck it. Yeah. I see the bolt that struck it.
Yeah.
Because it was 3 fingers that come out of that. The Royal Town Lodge in Springfield burnt that night. The church in Wilmot Center burnt. Down the Ragged Mountain Fishing Game, I got 3 structure fires from that one bolt that come down through all simultaneously.
He was on the road from Andover to Wilmot when he saw the...
And people don't realize, you know, we got one road coming off 4A. There used to be a fork right there.
Yes,
and
that's right.
Bill Call, he lived in a house right next to the church is standing
Joyce Litchie is.
And we had one of the old hand crank sirens, and Bill was right there just cranking his dear life out for it. Everything was gone just a split second. That church was, the whole thing was almost like bang, it was all on fire because it split the steeple. When that bell, the bell was almost setting right on the doorstep where it landed.
That's right, it came right down through.
Come right straight down and split like a wedge. And we didn't have the equipment then. And Andover, of course, was at Ragged Mountain Fishing Game, the one that went to Royal Town, and they left and come down to there to help us out. But we was making Connie Forsman's house. We were just putting water on that to keep the heat away. That was all. Because, you know, an old structure. And what hurt us the most, because there was a metal ceiling and it all come right down on top. So we just let it burn.
Yeah.
I mean, not everything was gone. It was all gone within an hour and a half. We got to talking one night at my grandfather's kitchen. He said, why don't you go pick your piece of land out you want to build your house on? So I said, well, we'll build it right up the road here. We had all the lumber off his farm, and her father and another guy had the sawmill, so we just took it down there and sawed it out. You know, no mortgage, no planning board back then.
He didn't have to have a building permit. That first Christmas, we moved into the house on Christmas Eve. We had no water, no running water, no bathroom.
My uncle was right across the street. Of course, we were young then. We was only, I was 19 and you was 19.
No, I was 18.
I'd go before the judge to get married down at Concord. They'd take my mother down. She said, what are you got to get married? We said, no. Well, he looked at both of us. He said, well, why don't you, I'm going to write you up, because he said, you might as well, because you might.
You might as well before you have to.
He was quite an old character. I don't even know who his name was.
I don't remember either. It was an interesting time. That Christmas, we had just, the insulation was the old insulation that was the foil. And that's what our walls were. We plugged in the Christmas tree and we had Christmas trees all around us. From that
reflection.
And insulation.
And the next spring we finished it all off. And
lacto frozen to death that winter, though.
Well, we've been there, 3 years, 4 years? Well, 3 years. Well, Mark was born, then Michael was born, and I said we went to get a mortgage.
On the house.
Went to Franklin Bank. We figured we'd never get one. New London Trust just barely started. And that's why we borrowed $4,000 to put a 26 by 36 foot addition. Yeah.
My father just about had a fit because we had a mortgage.
Yeah.
What were we doing? Putting our house in jeopardy.
$47 a month. Then we sold the house right in the middle of winter. I owned this piece of land back of Woodley, where Gavin Campbell lives now.
Yeah.
We bought that piece the following summer. We put the house on the market. Sold the house in February. We moved in.
End of March. Yeah.
Frost was that deep in that sand. A month to the day we signed the papers, I was working for Woodley then. It was a prefab. They come out of Millis, Mass. That year we put up, I had 5-man crew. And God knows I only had 5 men. We made the National Home Builders magazine. We put up 75 houses. Yeah. I was on the road most of the time. But.
Now you had 2 sons and a daughter?
Two sons.
Mark lives in Manchester.
Michael.
Works down in Newfields. About 60, 70 hours a week. I got him on salary, and he's pretty much running the factory down there and stuff.
Now you played baseball in high school?
Yeah, I played baseball when I was 43 years old.
It was neat, though, because we were all reasonably young at that point. None of us had any money. We all had kids, you know, and so we'd pack picnic lunches and follow the guys wherever the ball game was, and the kids would have a good time playing,
and we girls would do our girl things.
And, it was all we could afford to do.
And it was
enough. It was our social life.
Where was the ball field in Andover?
Right there in Proctor, where Proctor is now. The ball field, it used to be the ball field. They moved that around 3 different times, just like our ball field over here. Our original ball field, home plate right underneath Route 11. I've redone that ball field 3 times. I put the underground sprinkler system in when we redone it the last time.
Mm-hmm.
The 368 engineers were over there working, and they come down here, and we put the beach, and we'd be thrown in jail today if we'd done it now like we did then. We had to have a tank retriever come in and get a D8 out. They got us, there was a little island out there that's gone now, because they brought a crane in. They did, and they took all the muck out, and that was nothing but a swamp.
Yeah.
I mean, we clear cut that whole thing. It was absolutely nothing but a junky swamp. Now we got a nice beach out of it. We spent every stinking night after that beach got in. All the guys our age, Stanley Reno and Keith Flurry and Al Hansen, they lived in Wilmot Center Hill, and all the kids were the same age. And most of the time we ate supper down there. Everybody would bring stuff and we'd all eat together and stuff like that. You
guys
know,
would play horseshoes because they could go onto the island at that point.
We had a bridge, and I guess some of the wood had found out maybe we didn't own that island. But that's why the bridge never got put back in.
But there was a little enclosure building on it. It was open to the weather, but at least it was where you could get in out of the rain.
That building right there where the bathrooms are, it was over the Dick Bacon's, and I think it was an old railroad shed. I don't know where it come from, but Lonnie Rowe was alive then. He had his construction business and tag along trailer. So, well, I said, there ain't going to be any problem to move that. I said, let me tell you something. It's going to be a problem because that slate roof weighs a lot of pounds and stuff. Well, I said, don't get excited. I said, I'll go home and get a couple of plank and some rolls. And we rolled it right up onto this trailer because that sat right over a big septic tank right there. And then you had to come pump it out all the time. They still do. And we unloaded. It was getting dark. It was really pitch dark. And we unloaded it. She come right off almost the perfect, right where we wanted it to set, and that's why she sat ever since. We've done all that stuff, yeah. Then. We didn't pay any money to have the work done, like the ball field.
Didn't have any money to pay. Yeah.
But,
you know,
like the community center, I worked hundreds of hours in there. I was living in North Wilmot then. Refurbished the whole thing, ripped it all out, and I done all the ceilings in the bottom. One of those, never had lung cancer, you know, didn't why they didn't have masks in there. All that stuff was done for nothing. Now everything's got to be paid for. Then we had bingo. That's another thing that supported the community center. And we take turns. I call bingo, you know. And John Spearman would call. John and I'd be calling. We'd switch off back and forth 1 week and the next week and stuff like that. But we had all the people that donated their time, and that's what all the kids benefited from it, because it didn't cost an arm and a leg, because it wasn't that many big dollars then. And stuff like that, but
you did the work.
I mowed the ball field for years.
You did the work for the organizations that your kids were involved in, and then when they moved on to something else, then you moved on, you know. And
I was right close by, and I'd have to take a can of gas with me because I had to ride a lawnmower and stuff. And when I was playing softball, I kept it up to in the irrigation system. When we got done playing softball, that's when the field started going to pot.
We're about out of time. And you guys have been wonderful. Absolutely wonderful.
Well, a lot of change has been going on over the years, good and for bad, but you know.
Yeah.
But everybody worked together back then. Yeah. You know. Because we didn't have any new houses going in then.
Well, Wilmot's a choice place to live now for young people. We've got mixed ages. We've got
well,
a lovely
we're all,
place
we're
to
centrally
live.
Located between Concord and Hanover.
Exactly.
Yeah. And easy access.
Yep.
It is now because you're right so close to the interstate.
And there are a lot of families on my street where the mom works in one direction, the dad works in the other,
yeah.
So we're central for that same reason.
Yeah.
I never knew where I was going to work. I was on the road all the time. I mean, I traveled from Vermont to Mass, building houses when I worked for Wood in 1 week.
Oof.
He'd have built me a house in Burlington if I'd have, to show you how stubborn I was. I'd have had the house for nothing, as long as I stayed up there and built the house as well. Working on the end of Lake Champlain ain't no dream.
Yeah.
Well, we enjoyed your stories. Thanks so much for sharing with us.
Well, thank you for coming.
Indeed.
Yeah, we're great.
You brought back a lot of memories.